The next thing to discuss after Western expansion is compromise and conflict, and this is centered around slavery. The unfortunate reason for that is that once you have gained a bunch of additional land, leadership is going to wonder, will we allow slavery in these new lands, or won't we? In 1820, prior to a lot of Western expansion, prior to the presidency of James K. Polk and Manifest Destiny, the Missouri Compromise addressed whether Missouri would enter the Union as a slave state or a free state. The decision could disrupt the balance of power in Congress because prior to the Missouri Compromise, there were equal number of slave states and free states. Therefore, power in the Senate specifically was equal because of equal representation. So the balance of power in Congress is being addressed here. Henry Clay, known as the Great Compromiser, strikes up an agreement that both sides could live with. The terms were that Missouri would be admitted as a slave state, Maine would be admitted as a free state, and the 36 degree 30 minute latitude line, which was the southern border of Missouri, would separate slave from free territory from there on. Here's a map of the compromise. Maine entered as a free state, Missouri as a slave state, and this separated free and slave territory. This territory out west was yet to be controlled by the United States, so this seemed to be a solution for all time. However, after the Mexican War, California has a population explosion after the gold rush of 1849, and they apply for statehood. Henry Clay oversees yet another compromise. The terms are that California will enter as a free state. The remainder of the Mexican cession would decide freedom or slavery based on popular sovereignty. Very important term. It just means that the citizens vote on the future of an issue, in this case, slavery. The slave trade in Washington, D.C. would be outlawed, and the Fugitive Slave Act would be more strictly enforced. Here is a map of this decision. California is admitted as a free state. Utah, New Mexico are subject to future votes on the issue of slavery. In 1854, the Kansas-Nebraska Act brought up the issue of slavery again because both Kansas and Nebraska's populations qualified for statehood. Senator Stephen Douglas, a Democrat from Illinois, leads the way in Congress on the passage of a new law. The terms are that both Kansas and Nebraska would decide the fate of slavery in their territories before applying and receiving statehood status. This was not popular in the North. Illinois happens to be in the North. But Stephen Douglas was aligning for a presidential run, and any Democrat who wanted to run for president in the 1850s would need the support of southern states. Here is a map of the Kansas-Nebraska Act, Kansas and Nebraska territories in orange. Now, the conflict side of things. Stephen Douglas's compromise seemed good in theory, seems great on paper, but it leads to violent conflict as people flow into the territories over the next couple of years to stuff the ballot box. It's referred to as Bleeding Kansas today, and it made John Brown famous. This painting is of John Brown. He and some of his followers were very, very adamantly abolitionist. They killed slave owners, as a matter of fact. They would enter their homes at night and murder them in their sleep. Dred Scott v. Sanford in 1857 is an extremely, extremely important Supreme Court case that you must know. Dred Scott is a slave, and he is suing his owner for taking him into a free territory. He argues that this makes him free. In the decision, Chief Justice Roger Taney writes the majority opinion, and he specifies that Scott is not a citizen and therefore could not sue in federal court. They could have stopped there, left it at that. We're throwing this case out because you do not have citizenship and cannot sue in federal court. Taney goes further. He also says slaves are property and therefore can be taken into free states as long as residency there is not permanently established by the owner. The Missouri Compromise was unconstitutional because it denied slave owners their property rights. This is a landmark Supreme Court decision that is extremely unpopular among those who would consider themselves to be abolitionists. This is a photograph of Dred Scott taken during the proceedings. Uncle Tom's Cabin. Harriet Beecher Stowe publishes this book describing the horrors of the Southern chattel slavery system. It spurs even more abolitionist debate in the North, and more Northerners are beginning to identify themselves as abolitionists. In 1859, John Brown, the same man from Bleeding Kansas, attacks the federal arsenal at Harper's Ferry, Virginia. He hopes that he can seize weapons, arm the local slave population, and start a slave rebellion. Oddly enough, it is Colonel Robert E. Lee who leads federal troops to put down the rebellion. John Brown is convicted of treason and hung for his crimes. In his trial, John Brown puts the system of slavery on trial. He knows that he's going to die, so he simply gives speeches during his trial damning the system of slavery. This is John Brown in his younger years on the left, and John Brown as he looked during Bleeding Kansas and during the raid on Harper's Ferry. The last thing that really leads to pro-slavery and anti-slavery sentiments in Congress is the disintegration of the Whig Party. The Whig Party was very powerful from the early to mid-1800s. However, they refused to take a stance on slavery. The reason they do so is because they're trying to appeal to both the North and the South. Senator Henry Clay of Kentucky is a famous Whig. The Compromise of 1850 and Kansas-Nebraska Act in 1854 began to divide the party over slavery because some people were becoming abolitionists and they wanted the party to take a strong stance. But again, the party does not want to take a stance on slavery because they think that they can appeal to both sides. Unfortunately, all it does is make both sides angry. Abolitionists want the Whigs to support abolition, and Southerners want the Whigs to openly support the system of slavery. By 1852, the Whig presidential candidate, General Winfield Scott, won only 4 states. As Whigs divided further, the American Party, also known as the Know-Nothings, ran on a platform of anti-immigration and anti-Catholicism. And eventually, the Republican Party replaces the declining Whig Party. That leaves us off with what our next presentation will be about, which is the rise of the Republican Party and the breakup of the Union. This is the end of the presentation. Please make sure that you take the online quiz. Use your notes on the online quiz. If you use your notes, there's no reason you can't get a perfect score. Thank you. See you in class.